بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، فيهدي الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ونبيك محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. وأما بعد، أيها الإخوة الكرام، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن شاء الله today this will be the last session regarding this course, purification of the heart and the soul. And I will try today to make some sort of summary, briefing, what we have already discussed, as well as coming to the end with the way of curing and treatment of some of these diseases of the heart which affect our iman and our deen. And then if we have time, we will keep some few minutes for questions and answers, and if there is any comments or suggestions, I will be happy to listen and hear from you, inshallah. We said that the main organ in the human being, which is the king and the leader of all the organs, is the heart. And this is very clear when Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there is a morsel in the body, if it is sound, everything will be sound. If it is corrupted, everything will be corrupted. And the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it is the heart. And we talked about the heart according to the ayat and the verses coming in the Holy Quran. And we found that this heart can be a heart full of iman, sound, heart repent, heart salim, heart mukhbit. This is the heart of the believers, which is full of iman, and it worships Allah by the worships of the heart, which is loving Allah, fearing Allah, trusting on Allah, relying on Allah, having hope with Allah, and so and so. This heart, or the hearts of the believers, القلوب المؤمنة, قلب مخبت, قلب منيب, قلب سليم, and so on. You will find many ayat talks about this. Then we talked about diseased heart, sick heart. And it is mentioned in the Quran, في قلوبهم مرض. There is a disease in their heart. And we talked about this, explaining that this disease is not a pathological disease, it is spiritual disease. It is the disease of nifaq. When it comes, the major nifaq is kufr. And the person is pretending to be a Muslim. He is a munafiq. And the nifaq is a disease in the heart. That is, the person is a kafir, but he is pretending to be a Muslim. So you will find many ayat in the Quran talking about those. Munafiqun, aw fi qulubihim marad. And we went into some details regarding this matter. Al-nifaq al-akbar and al-nifaq al-asghar. Minor nifaq and the major nifaq. And we mentioned that the minor nifaq can affect any Muslim who is sinning, as to be a liar, to break your promise, give covenant and you don't fulfill it, and going extreme when you are disagreement with others, and so on. Ayat al-Munafiq. And this amrad, sickness, if it is embedded in the heart and you don't treat it, it can take you from nifaq to kufr. From nifaq to kufr. The issue of nifaq is highly clarified in the Quran and Sunnah. Many, many ayat talks about al-munafiqi. Yani when you go to Surah Al-Tawbah, for example, it is named Al-Tawbah, and it has other names, Al-Fadiha. Al-Fadiha. Fadiha. It gives scandal to the munafiqi. Al-Muqashqisha. Al-Mudamdima. Al-Tawbah. the same surah, which talks a lot about al-munafiqeen, hypocrites. And we discussed the first verses in Surah Al-Baqarah. The first ayat in Surah Al-Baqarah talks about two types of hearts. In verse number 6 and 7, the hearts of the kuffar. It is khatama, khatama Allahu ala qulubihim. There is a seal on their heart. They are kuffar. And the next ayat, 12 ayah from ayah number 7 till ayah number 19, talking about al-munafiqeen, and Allah described them as they are heart disease. في قلوبهم مرض فزادهم الله مرضا ولهم عذاب أليم. And we said that the diseases also can be divided into two categories. Disease of suspicious and doubt, اللي هو أمراض الشبهات. And the disease of lust and desires. The disease of shahawat, we said that it is normal in every human being to have desires. But if desires go beyond the limit, or being uncontrolled, or you became slave to your desires, this is the disease, comes here. The disease of suspicion and the doubts comes mainly with ignorance. Being an ignorant, and you are listening to people who are attacking Islam, giving doubts about Islam, talking bad about the deen and the religion, and you have no defense in your heart of knowledge. Your heart will be sick and ill, and your iman will decrease and it may demolish. Regarding the shahawat, al-ma'asi, the sins comes here. Yani, sinning. And for example, the issues of zina, issues of stealing, also lying, and so on and so. These sins, if you continue performing without repenting, it will affect the iman in your heart. And we mentioned Hadith Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, an authentic Hadith in Bukhari or in Muslim, Ahad al-Sahihain, when the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, the sinner, if he doesn't repent from his sins, a black spot in his heart. If he continues sinning, the black spot will increase. Blacking, 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 darkening. At the end, his heart will be completely dark. If you are sinning and you repent, it will be white. If it comes a fitna, a trial, and you pass it, succeeded, you didn't fall into the sin, your heart will be whitening. And at the end, Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, the hearts will be one of two. The first one, which is sinning and sinning without repentance, it will be completely dark, blocked as a rock. In this case, the maw'idah will be of no benefit. And the iman now will be demolished. And it is the soft target for the shaitan. Khalas, you are very, very weak. Because you are following your desires and sinning and you don't repent. And in this case, Rasulullah said, the good for this man is what he desires. And the bad is what he doesn't like. He doesn't follow the truth. He follows his desire. The other heart which repents, the heart which succeeds regarding the trials, it will be whitened, whitened, whitened. Iman will increase. And it will be established. And Rasulullah ﷺ said at the end of the hadith, this heart of this believer will be completely white. لا تضره الفتنة. No fitna will affect you later on. We want to reach this level of keeping iman in our hearts, increasing the iman in our hearts, protecting the iman in our hearts. And of course, when we talked about the diseased heart, we found the Quran, the dead heart, also the Quran described them in different ayat in the Holy Quran. يعني قلب ميت, dead heart, قلب قاسي, very hard heart, قلوب, يعني there is no way It is a sealed heart. This is the heart of the kafir. We mentioned that since this is the main organ in the body, it is the place of iman and the kufr and the fisq and the nifaq. It is the base of intention and motivation. Everything follows the heart. Yani, you start and the organs will follow what you will, you wish, you intended. And we mentioned that intention starts from the heart. طيب, we said that the shaitan, every one of us has his own shaitan created. And there is the targets of the shaitan dealing with you. We talked about the waswasa and how Allah described the waswasa, whispering of the shaitan. قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ مِنْ شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسِ. And the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, he is running in your body as the blood vessels running. What is the main target for the shaitan now? It is your heart. It is your heart. Since the heart is the king, if you corrupt the king, everything will be corrupted. If the heart is bad, no iman in it, you will do everything bad. You will be a sinner. You will not think about Allah or Akhirah. Your iman will be withdrawn. So the main target for the shaitan is your heart. We talked also in one of the sessions about the temptation of the heart. What does the heart, the shaitan wants from you? We said, as Ibn al-Qayyim explained, six or seven levels. Number one, he wants to tell you to be a kafir or a mushrik. And he will never leave you, trying by every way and all the means to destroy the iman and the tawheed in your heart. Turn you to kufr or to shirk. This is number the main issue. Then, to innovation. To get you away from the straight path. And these innovations can be kufr. Bid'ah mukaffira. Yani, a new religion. A new thoughts. This may even contradicting Islam completely. Some bid'ah are kufr. Some bid'ah are less in kufr. And there are bid'ah in everything we said. There are bid'ah in aqidah, bid'ah in ibadah. There is bid'ah in salah, bid'ah in adhkar, bid'ah in siyam, bid'ah in al-umrah, hajj, bid'ah in everything. Bid'ah in the way you worship Allah, a way to take you away from the path of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The third one is to push you to major sin. And he will go with you to minor sins. Then he will destroy the priorities to which you can get high rewards. If he cannot go with all of this, he will go with you to let you lose the priorities, getting good hasana. If he fails in all of this, and you are highly protecting yourself by strong iman and strong knowledge, he will go through his allies of human being and other jinn. Min al-jinnati wal-nas. So, one of the things is that he will spread myths about you by the people around you, destroying your reputation, isolating you. Or the shaitan, may attack you through other shayateen or other human beings who are shayateen al-ins. And we mentioned two things, hasad, envy, and sihr, sorcery. So these are parts of the temptation. Sihr and al-hasad, really, Sheikh Ibn Taymiyyah wrote a wonderful book and article about these two things. Envy and the envious eyes, and how the soul of the envious person is a very wicked soul. The al-hasid, he wishes that you lose what Allah had given you, even if he wouldn't get it. And the sahir and the sihr is wanting to harm you. through using jinn, a kafir jinn with a kafir sahir to harm the Muslim. And we also discussed the issue of the easiest way for protection from this is qira'at al-mu'awwadatayn. Qul a'udhu bi rabbil falaq, qul a'udhu bi rabbin nas. And today, inshallah, when we go to curing and how to make the shields against the shaitan, we will mention these quickly again. Last session, we were talking about the ways entering of the shaitan. Yani, how the shaitan enters and the gates are more open for him. To attack you, to attack your iman, to withdraw and decrease your iman. And as we mentioned several times, when you are with a strong iman, the shaitan is very weak. Very weak, your qareeb. When you are in a weak iman, he is very strong with you. And this is a very important point to mention, because the issue of position of jinn is very rare. Many people, when they are in some sort of hardship, or they will say, oh, he is possessed by jinn. Possession by jinn is very, very rare to have. What is the case? The case is your qareen is flourishing and strengthening, and you are weak and weak and weak. So he inspires in you that there are other shayateen coming, inhibiting you, possessing you. And the reality is, it is your own shaitan become very strong on you, and you are very, very weak. So it is not always yani, the issue is position of jinn. No, position of jinn is a very rare condition. Very rare condition. It may happen. It may happen. But it is very, very rare. The majority of cases is that you become very, very weak, and your shaitan is now playing on you. So a person may have some what you call fits. It may be pathological fits. People will say, okay, this is because of the shaitan. Come to recite Quran, I will come to scream and shout. And the other people say, oh, there is a shaitan possessing him, talking. And look at him and listen to him. It is your own shaitan. And whenever you are weak and weak, he is more and more strong. And Allah described the shaitan that his kaid, mockery, is very weak. إِنَّ كَيْدَ الشَّيْطَانِ كَانَ ضَعِيفٌ. And the Rasulullah said to the man when he was very angry, and we mentioned that anger is a way for the shaitan to flourish, to work hard on you. The Rasulullah said to him, say, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Say, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. He will flee. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. I seek refuge with Allah from the shaitan. And one of the great things which we also have to remind ourselves, reciting every day, قل هو الله أحد, قل أعوذ برب الفلق, قل أعوذ برب الناس. When you wake up in the morning, first thing to do. Before you sleep, first thing to do before you sleep. After each salah, farida, try to recite them. Very simple, very easy. And the Rasulullah said, protection of the shaitan and protection of the hasad, the ayn, of the sihr, and so on. And we will find also ayat al-kursi. Ayat al-kursi, Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum. The Rasulullah said to Abu Huraira, the shaitan, when he was trying to steal the money of zakah, the authentic hadith, then the shaitan said to Abu Huraira, do you know, if you come to sleep and you recite ayat al-kursi, no shaitan can come or approach you. Abu Huraira said this. The shaitan was in the shape of a man at that time, and he came to steal the zakah in which Abu Huraira was guarding. The hadith is well known. Abu Huraira went to the Prophet and he said to him, Ya Rasulallah, the thief told me so and so and so. The Rasulullah said to him, yes, this is true. What he told you is truth. to recite Ayat al-Kursi every night before sleeping, it is a shield from the shaitan. Also, you know, when you sleep, sometimes you have dreams. I think also we talked about this. There is a dream, Hilm, and there is a Ru'ya. I don't know Ru'ya how it is translated in English, but Hulm, dream, يعني إيه الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said الحلم من الشيطان والرؤيا من الله الرؤيا من الله يعني it is a good scene, it may be warning and it may be giving you hope tidings or something. This is رؤيا, رؤيا, and you get a message from it. But الحلم is something to يعني very bad, to harm you. You look at yourself in this dream as if enemies around you and a dog eating your head and your hand وبلد وبتاع وفاير. The dreams can be anything. You jumped from a big mountain or seventh floor and you or a car شيطان playing on you while you are sleeping and you wake up very upset, depressed. This is shaitan. And the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, don't talk and don't say it. It is حلم, حلم من الشيطان. أما الرؤيا, الرؤيا من الله عز وجل. Sometimes you get hope tidings, good things, or warning you of something, it comes as a رؤيا. The shaitan is with us from birth till death. And your shaitan knows you very well. And he knows where is the point of weakness. Last time we were talking about entries of the shaitan and we mentioned some of them. Today we will finish them and we will go quickly with the shields of the shaitan. We said that anger and ignorance both are very prominent gates for the shaitan to enter and attack you. Ignorance, of course, if you are ignorant and stay ignorant all your life, you are a very easy target for the shaitan. One of the main protection for the Muslim, for the believer, is to seek knowledge. You have to seek knowledge. And I mean by knowledge to know Allah, to know your Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to know Quran, to know the Hadith, to know the Fiqh, to come closer to Allah, to know your deen. Don't be ignorant in your religion, in your deen. Don't be ignorant in your relation with your God. So you will find many ayat, many ahadith talking about this point. Seek knowledge. وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. Allah will raise the rank of the knowledgeable people. Don't be ignorant. Either you are a scholar or a student of knowledge. Don't be the third. The third are the public who knows nothing and they are just led as if they are blind. And we talked about ignorance and how ignorance is part of being misguided, misleaded. And ignorance opened the gate of bid'ah. Very easy. A few days we were talking with the brothers from Bangladesh and I asked him, do you really have a day of dua? On the day of dua. Many Bengali Muslims, they gather once a year for about 2 or 3 days. 1 million or 2 million. And they stay with camps and so eating, drinking and praying. And then the third day they make a dua jama'i, congregation dua. Are there brothers from Bangladesh here? Fainir Bengali, huh? Aha. Is it right? What do you call this day? Istima. Istima? Istima? Yes, yes. The old man yesterday, he told us about this. What is this? He said, oh, gathering. 1 million. Dua, dua. Is dua haram? It is not haram. What you are doing is haram. What you are doing is haram. Completely haram. Nah. Will never be accepted. To gather people, thousands, and tell them that there will be the day of the dua, and the imam will make a dua, and all of you say ameen and ameen. And many of them thinks that it is a holy day. It is a day of repentance. It is a day of forgiveness. And some of the brothers, they told me, and people come thousands of miles, even from Pakistan and India and so and so. Did the Prophet do this, alayhi wasalam? Never. Did Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Khulafa, Rashid did it? Never. Did any of the mu'mineen at the time of the Prophet did it? Never. To gather 100,000 of people and say to them, this specific day, every year, this is a bid'ah. Completely bid'ah. And always when there is a bid'ah, you are killing a sunnah. Whenever there is a bid'ah, there is a sunnah to be killed. What is the sunnah? The sunnah here is to make dua by yourself. There is no gathering for dua. The gathering is in Mecca for Hajj. The gathering is in Medina when you go to visit al-Masjid al-Nabawi. This is the only gathering. Rasulullah said, لا تشد الرحال إلا إلى ثلاث. Al-Masjid al-Haram, Al-Masjid al-Aqsa, Al-Masjid hada. Anything other than this, it is a bid'ah. To travel for a religious reason. Only to Mecca, Medina, and Masjid al-Aqsa. Inshallah, we'll get it soon, bi-idhnillah. Yani, as soon as Syria is liberated, al-Aqsa will be, inshallah, very soon. And alhamdulillah, the news nowadays that the liberal army is attacking Damascus. Alhamdulillah. Yani, I think, bi-idhnillah, in Ramadan or before that, the very kafir regime of Assad will be finished very soon, inshallah. And at that time, the victory for the believer, yeah. Syria is very, very important. Sham is very important. Yeah. By coming back to ignorance and anger, we said that al-akhsaruna a'malan, in the Quran described them, that they are the losers and they think that they are doing well. Take care. Take care. Try to study and learn. Sit down. Sit down in front of a sheikh, a scholar, a teacher, and try to learn. Don't be ignorant all of your life. Be a student of knowledge. Look how the parents nowadays, or for a long time, they are very keen that their student, their son, get a certificate. Okay, primary, secondary, very good. Okay, university, very good. Can you continue? Master, PhD, work? Okay, no problem with this. But the main problem is you have to be very keen for his deen, your son and your daughter. Teach them Quran from early age. Teach them Arabic. Put them on the straight path. And you yourself, I said it before, an old man coming, ya Sheikh, take my son. I want him to be a reciter of the Quran. I want him, very good, alhamdulillah, a very good father. What about you? No. How many juz you recite? No, I know nothing. Ya Ibn, what's this? What is this? Allah says, قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ. Save your neck and your family. Don't think that you have granted paradise for yourself. No, think about yourself. Yeah, it is shame to be 20 or 30 and you cannot recite one ayah of the Quran. You don't memorize 10 hadith of the Prophet. For ignorance is the main gate for the shaitan to destroy you completely. What is the cure, ya Sheikh? It is very simple. The cure, the treatment is close this gate of ignorance by circles of knowledge, by sitting down, spending time to seek knowledge. Nothing else. A new problem will be raised. When and where and how. And sahih, this is a real problem. From where I get the knowledge? Who will teach me? When I don't have time, working 24/7, I have to. This is barayya, not my problem. It is your problem. Yani one of the good things yani the brothers are doing here is doing these circuits of knowledge. They are trying to cover this defect in our life. And if I have the authority, I would make yani these circles in the schools, teaching the Quran and the Hadith and the Sunnah and the Seerah and the Arabic, obligatory, compulsory for every Muslim. You will never take any certificate without passing certain level. Like if there is no government like this, nobody is keen to teach the Muslimin or to save their deen. It is your responsibility for yourself and for your wife and for your children. So here the Sheikh talked a lot about the issue of ignorance. We mentioned it, anger, and we said that when you are angry, you lose the control. The shaitan can yani destroy you completely. I mentioned many stories how he destroys families, how he made a person killing the other because he was very angry. You can divorce your wife in a moment of anger. In anger, Rasulullah ﷺ said, calm down. If you are standing, sit down. Sitting, lay down. Don't make a decision. Don't talk in anger. And he said, the strongest one of you is the man who controls his anger. And you can see how the people go astray when they are angry. Then we said that also one of the gates of the shaitan, loving the worldly life, and also this is a big issue. Nowadays it is very glittering. Everyone wants more, possessing, and things are very attractive. So loving dunya means that you are taking the space of loving akhirah. And if loving dunya overcome, you are a loser. You want to be keen to worship Allah. You want to be keen to get hasana. You want to be keen to be a slave. Because if you're loving dunya too much, more than the normal, again, more than normal, you will be vulnerable for the shaitan to remove the iman in your heart. Because 1,000 is not enough, you are running in this dunya to get 10,000 and half a million. Small car is not enough, you want the biggest. One woman is not enough, you want two or three. Everything will be not enough in your eyes. And you want more and more and more. Greedy. Tamba. Is there a limit? No limit. No limit. No limit. What is the limit? As the Prophet ﷺ said, when the dust is in your belly. If you have a valley of gold, you wish to get to the second. If you have two valleys of gold, Rasulullah ﷺ said, you wish to get to the third. Nothing will satisfy you except when the dust come, dust full your belly. When the dust full my belly? When? When you are old? No. When? When you are dead. When you are dead, in the grave. Very good. So you will not be, try to control yourself regarding indulging in dunya. Try to put a limit. Try to put a limit to be satisfied. Don't be as a kafir. Yeah. Because the kafir thinks that it is A to Z is his life here. As a believer, we don't say this at all. At all. This is very temporary. We are just crossing a bridge to the real life. So, loving world is against iman. I mean loving world more beyond the real need. Like, what is the real need? One will say, okay, we are living in London and we have to get, I am married, I want a two-bedroom flat, I want very good furniture, I want a big screen, TV, internet, I want so and so and so. I want a car, I want my fridge to be full of food. Who can tell us the limits? Who is our teacher? Rasulullah. But if we compare ourselves to the Prophet ﷺ, or the Sahaba, or the Tabi'een, you will find how far we are. How far we are. Yani Sahaba are human beings like us. They eat and they drink, they have wives and children, and they are working and trade. Look how Rasulullah ﷺ taught them to close this gate of the shaitan, loving the dunya. And at the same time, many of them are very rich. Try to realize the fact that it doesn't mean leaving the dunya or being a zahid that you are poor. No. You may be rich and you have this great character. It is the issue of your heart. How loving the dunya is in your heart? How is it? What is the space of loving the akhirah in your heart? You may be a multimillionaire, but you're still loving akhirah, asking Allah, doing your best for akhirah. As the Sahaba, Abdurrahman ibn Awf was a millionaire. Zubair ibn Awam was a millionaire. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he started in Islam with the Prophet, he was a big trading merchant man. But look what happened to them regarding the world around them. It was nothing in their eyes. If it comes, alhamdulillah. If it goes, alhamdulillah. And this is the main issue. It is not established, inhabited in your heart. And Rasulullah said, Allahumma arzuq ala Muhammadin kifafa. Oh Allah, give them their necessity. Sayyidah Aisha said, a month and 2 months passes, there is no cooked food in the houses of the Prophet, all his houses. Hadith al-ju'a. Al-ju'a, yani hunger. Imagine, the Prophet himself goes out from his house, there is no piece of bread to eat. He went out. He found Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr was the same thing. Nothing to eat. Then they found Umar. Nothing to eat in his house. No savings. Nowadays, if you go to any one of us, go to his fridge, yeah, you can find food for 1 month or 1 year even. And your bank account and your everything is alhamdulillah. But the Muslim, the real Muslim, yani he takes the necessity, what he needs. If Allah gives him, alhamdulillah, no problem. I am not saying to you, be a poor person, or beg the people, no. No. But don't put this dunya in your heart. You know yourself. You know yourself. And the shaitan knows you better. Take care of this. It is not a matter that we are talking to each other. The point here is, the shaitan running with you, he knows you. And he knows what you wish. So he will penetrate. He will enter through these defective points in your heart. Here the Sheikh talked about this one, about the anger and the dunya and the loving this world. And he said the shaitan adorns this worldly life and makes it seem good in the hearts of many people. So they have willingly embraced it and held tight to it. They compete with envy, fight each other for it. It is all the planning of Iblis. Iblis, the shaitan said, as mentioned in the Holy Quran, رَبِّ بِمَا أَغْوَيْتَنِي لَأُزَيِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ. I will beautify this world. Oh my Lord, because you misled me, I will make things on the earth seem good, beautified to them, and I will mislead them all. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the dunya, as we mentioned last time. It is lahu wa la'ib wa zina wa tafakh. I'lamu annama al-hayatu al-dunya. Hayatu al-dunya, yani the worldly life. What is it? Allah said lahu wa la'ib. زينة تفاخر. اعلموا أنما الحياة الدنيا لعب ولهو وزينة وتفاخر بينكم وتكاثر في الأموال والأولاد. Oh, know that the life of this world is merely a game and a diversion and ostentation and a cause of boasting among yourselves and trying to undo one another in wealth and children. Then he gave the example of water coming, rain, plants grow, then after a while it is finished. This is the dunya. Very short. Very short. And it is glittering. But in its reality, it has a very short end. So try to be wise enough to make the balance in your heart. Make the balance in your heart. Even with the halal things. Okay, money and income is halal when you get it from halal sources. Don't make it your main concern. Don't run 24/7 to increase and increase, and this may become the first and the last thing in your mind. You find a lot of Muslims like this. He is excellent in the issues of trading or IT or buying and selling or expert in umur of the dunya. عالم بأمر الدنيا جاهل بالآخرة. إن الله يبغض كل جعوضي جواب. عالم بالدنيا جاهل بالآخرة. حمار بالنهار جيفة بالليل. The saying, يعني, I'm not sure about the hadith, but the meaning of it is that Allah hates those who are running day and night as if they are donkeys in the day time and they are dead at the night time. They are experts of the things of the dunya and they are nothing regarding the akhirah. Don't be one of those. So that this is about the dunya and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us a lot about akhirah. Compete and run and do your best for al-akhirah. Okay. Now we said also that being greedy and having the hirs, in Islam we say the Arabic word here is hirs. Rasulullah said, if you become greedy and you become very wanting person, especially in two things, in the issues of wealth and the issues of prestige. ما ذئبان جائعان أرسلا في غنم بأفسد لهما من حرص المرء على الجاه والمال لدينه. This will destroy your deen completely. As the two wolves are sent to sheep, how they will eat them and destroy them. Two hungry wolves. How they will eat the sheep? The same if you are very keen for gaining, greeding for money, this will destroy your deen and iman. And also, Rasulullah here, two hungry wolves, if let loose among a flock of sheep, will not do any more damage than that which is caused by a man's greed for wealth and status to his religion. Also, Rasulullah said, wealth doesn't mean abundance of property, but wealth is self-contentment. Contentment. You can be more rich than Bill Gates if you have self-contentment in your heart. Wallah, it is not the matter of how abundant you have. It is how it is in your heart. There is many ayat and the hadith here, but another issue is avarice, as well as being miser and stingy. الشيطان يعدكم الفقر ويأمركم بالفحشاء. Shaitan promises you poverty and commands you to be niggardly. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, you have to pay from your money for sake of Allah, to purify your money by zakah and sadaqah. But if you are very greedy, you are very selfish. Now, this is a very soft target for the shaitan. Either you are a man or a woman. Some people are like this. they like money. And they are as if you break your heart when you ask him to spend or to pay something. And Rasulullah said, those who don't pay zakat, their punishment will start in the grave before the day of judgment. And their money will be turned to be a huge snake that will goes around them. Punishment in the grave before the day of judgment. He said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, whoever is made wealthy by Allah and doesn't pay the zakah, the zakah is faridah, obligatory, for his wealth, then on the day of resurrection, his wealth will be made like a bald-headed, poisonous snake with two black spots over the eyes. The snake will encircle his neck and bite his cheek, saying, I am your wealth, I am your wealth, I am your treasure. This is very also important that we train ourselves. You have to train yourself. You have to fight yourself. If you are a miser, a stingy, you know yourself. Are you going to pay for sake of Allah? Are you paying sadaqah? Are you generous? You are hearing now about Syria, the disaster, the calamity. You heard about what happened in Somalia, for example, in Palestine. Nowadays, the massacre in Burma, 10,000 were killed, lasted 10 days. They need money. And you are, alhamdulillah, full. You have everything. And they ask you, Ya ibn al-Halal, pay something for sake of Allah. No. No. Very selfish. Very greedy. Taib, you are very weak in front of the shaitan. And the shaitan can turn this to be the points of defects which he knows and can destroy your deen and iman. You are loving dunya, you are loving wealth, you are very miser, stingy, you are very selfish. The iman will be withdrawn from your heart, either you wish or not. The last thing before we have a break, the shaitan will come to you in two issues also. Losing hope with Allah, being completely desperate, or thinking that you are completely guided and you will enter paradise. Look to these two issues which are against each other. He will come to you and he knows what can destroy you. Either there is no hope, khalas, finished, you are a sinner, Allah will never forgive you, and you have done a lot, so you are desperate. In this case, you are very, very weak. Very weak. Al-ya's. In the Arabic word, Quranic terminology, ya's. Ya'asa. Desperate. And Allah said, إِنَّهُ لَا يَيْأَسُ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. It will turn you to kufr. Don't ever, ever be desperate. Allah's mercy can come and approach and covers you at any time, whatever you have done. Everything, whatever you have done of even major, minor, anything except shirk, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. And the scholars here talked a lot about how the shaitan can destroy your deen completely, entering to you by telling you there is no hope with Allah. طيب, let us have a break, 3 or 4 minutes, and then we will continue. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. We said that there are many entries of the shaitan who knows you best, and he wants to, as we said before, takes your iman away. One of the issues we are struggling in our life to keep our iman, to increase our iman, to protect our iman. And we said it before that every day we are in trials regarding this iman. And these trials and tests differ. Sometimes the test may come for all the believers. Sometimes everyone has his own test. Sometimes the test is today and you are relaxed, tomorrow, the other day there is a huge or a major or a minor trial, tribulations. But at the end of the day, every day you are either saving your neck from hellfire or you are throwing yourself to hellfire. This is hadith of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. كل الناس يغدو فبائع النفس فمعتقها أو موبقها. Every day, since you are alive, you are as if you are going to the market, selling your soul. So either you succeed and you are saving it from hellfire, or you are a loser and throwing it to hellfire. Are you practicing your deen? Are you keeping your iman? What is your choices and what is your decision? In everything, are you following? Are you fearing Allah? Are you loving Allah? Are you doing according to the Quran? Or you are running behind yourself and your desires? So, how to protect this iman in our heart? How to prevent the shaitan from scratching this iman and demolishing it? We said that there are issues and gates that we have to close against the shaitan. Some of them which we were mentioned to, now we are talking about losing hope with Allah, and opposite of it, of losing the hope, you have lasting hope. Being desperate also is a big issue that can break your deen. And having a lasting hope also can break your deen. Lasting hope here, some people think that they are living forever. Or they say that, okay, let me enjoy my time now and then later on I can repent. I am still young, 20 or 22 or whatever. Oh, the future is in front of my eye. And this hope is really something coming from the shaitan to divert you from the straight path. Because as a believer, nobody knows. Yes?
There's a golf parked out there.
There is what?
In someone's car. Golf.
Golf?
Yeah. Does anyone have a golf registration? LT06CRF?
Anyone here has the golf car? If a person's hope lasts long, he or she becomes reluctant towards his religious duties by indulging in worldly matters and destroying his or her potential for the hereafter. Abu Huraira said, I hear the Prophet saying, the heart of an old man remains young in two respects, his love for the world, its wealth, amusements, luxuries, and his incessant hope. Even the old man, if you are old, he's still thinking that, okay, I will, inshallah, Allah will give me more, 10, 20, 50 years. Oh, I'm going to live for so and so and so. Nobody, yani, goes with the reality that nobody knows when everyone will die. It is something unknown at all, except by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when you have this lasting hope and you are misled and misguided by it, so you will be very reluctant and you will not work for akhirah. And you will think that as if you are living forever. Because of that, look, Rasulullah, what did he tell us regarding this matter? كُنْ فِي الدُّنْيَا كَأَنَّكَ غَرِيبٌ أَوْ عَابِرٌ سَبِيلٌ. Be in this world as if you are or you were a stranger or a traveler. Ibn Umar, when he used to say this hadith, he said, if you sleep at night, don't think you will be alive in the morning. If you wake up in the morning, don't be sure that you are alive in the evening. Be in this dunya as a stranger or a traveler. Do you know how the stranger is or the traveler? Any one of you, when he travels, have you traveled to another country for a week or 6 days? Very small bag. You are just wanting to do something and you are always preparing yourself to returning back. We have to be the same regarding this world. We are strangers. Here in this dunya, we have to prepare ourselves to return back to Allah in the akhirah. The stranger will not compete with the people of the land. The stranger always having very small things. The stranger and the traveler, they know that it is a short journey. And the Rasul, because of that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to him, be as a stranger in this dunya, or as a traveler, that you know that you are going to leave it very soon. This is lasting hope. We have also one of the things which can destroy completely your deen is kibr, which is al-ujb, yani arrogance, loving to be praised, loving praising, and comes with this ar-riya. These three issues, if you have one of them, you are far away from the straight path, and it is very easy for the shaitan to put you down. Arrogance. Arrogance, yani you are looking to yourself. You are arrogant. Your nose in the sky. You know some brothers, I just read a book, finish it. Now he comes to talk to you as if he is the greatest scholar. He's Ibn Taymiyyah talking to you. One, two books, khalas. Khalas. This is a munafiq, this is a mubtada', this is a kafir, this is Ibn Taymiyyah. Who are you? And he can give you fatwa in everything, whatever you ask him. Very arrogant. Very arrogant. Islam, especially this character, very, very bad character, try to kill it in yourself. Always be humble. Always. At-tawadu. Yani, from the beginning. And the Rasul ﷺ warned us all. If you see yourself, be sure that the shaitan is occupying your heart. Don't think about yourself at all. Don't think about yourself that you are something. Yeah. You want the people when they see you, Sheikh, Salamat, where are you? And you are always يعني, taking the feature of a VIP. We don't have this in Islam at all. And the Rasul ﷺ from the first day, he warned this. Because this character completely against the real deen. Because we are slaves. You have to understand that. You are a slave. I am a slave. My father is a slave. My son and my mother, my daughter. We are slaves. Slaves to Allah. Full stop. Slaves. يعني عبد. Don't look to yourself. As the Khalifa said, one of the scholars saw one of the Khulafa, Zu'ama, he was walking very arrogant like this. Then he looked to the scholar he was sitting in. He said to the Sheikh, the Imam, why you don't stand up for me? You don't, do you know me? Do you know me? Look to the answer. He said to him, yes, I know you. You started as a drop of semen. And he said to him, and you will die to be a rotten corpse. You started at a drop of semen, and you will die to be a rotten corpse. And between this and this, you are walking, carrying filth and dirty, urine and feces. And every one of us like this, we started by a drop of semen, صح. And we will end to be a decayed corpse. And we are walking, carrying urine and feces. So, calm down. Calm down. Enzim. Enzim. And if this disease comes to your heart, be sure you will never get knowledge. You will never have iman. You will always look down to others. And you are a shaitan. You are one of the shayatin. So arrogance is one of the worst diseases. And every one of us, as Ibn al-Qayyim said, have some sort of arrogance. You can show this arrogance to your wife. or to your children, or you may, it appears with your friends, or it appears in where you work. Oh, so he always, the scholars say, try to control this part. Always think that you are asleep. Be humble. Be humble. Don't look down to people at all. And when you see the Prophet ﷺ, he used to be one of the Muslimin, completely normal, nothing special for him at all. He sits on the ground, he eats with them, he walks, he sleeps under the tree. Umar ibn Khattab the same, and the Sahaba. Equality. Those Western, they say equality, وشارفية, freedom, this is rubbish. In Islam, the basic of this in Islam, we taught the whole world. What is equality? What is freedom? And how? All people are the same. Don't think because you are an Arab, you have any superiority. Or you are white with green eyes, you are handsome than the black one or the dark one. Rasulullah ﷺ from day one, and he said it in the Hajjat al-Wada', you are all equal. No priority, no superiority for an Arab over another Arab. For a white over a dark man. All of you belongs to Adam, and the Adam from dust. Full stop. Full stop. So this is Riya comes here showing you want to do something so that the people will praise you, and we got the disease of loving praising. It comes with the ujb and the riya. In this case, you don't work for Allah. You are doing this to get the praise from the people. The riya is very, very dangerous. Very dangerous. And you can be a murai and you don't feel it. This is the role of your teacher or the person who you are accompanying. He should advise you. And you have to see yourself. Look, the shaitan knows you very well. They told the story of when praying, and then when the people came around him, he lengthened his prayer and he beautified his sound. And when he finished, as if he is crying, oh, look at this. What a very pious man. And when the sheikh, I heard this in one of the tapes, the imam came to him and he said, oh, mashallah, you have a wonderful recitation. He said to him, oh, what if you know that I am always fasting also? Good recitation and fasting. This is riya. At the end of the day, you are making something to get the praise of the people, and you don't think in your doing of akhirah. The warning hadith is here, I think I said it before, the meritor who will be thrown to hellfire. The very generous man who will be thrown to hellfire, and the scholar or student of knowledge will be thrown to hellfire. Unfortunately, those three were munafiqeen, nifaq akbar. They had nothing in their hearts towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They were doing this for sure. طيب, I think by this, these are the main entrance of the shaitan. How to cure this? Every gate should be closed from the way the shaitan entered. The first thing, seeking knowledge, making dua, adhkar, as-salah, good companion, being sincere. And here the Sheikh really, he wrote many things, sincerity, ibadah, being with a good companionship in the jama'ah, pray the jama'ah, have your link with the mosque, reading the Quran, and make your link with the Quran. No way to increase your iman if you know nothing about the Quran. You have to do it. Make an effort. Quran and Sunnah. Then he said the isti'ada min al-shaytan, the reciting the Surah Al-Kursi, قُلْ وَاللَّهُ أَحَدْ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ, the last ayat of Surah Al-Baqarah, ذِكْرُ اللَّهِ, remembering Allah. Then غض البصر, lower your gaze, احفظ لسانك, don't talk much. And as we mentioned, the poisons of the heart as excessive eating, excessive sleeping, excessive abundant talking, all of this can be gradually stopped. And inshallah, if we have another chance, we can go more. But again, yani, I am just opening for you the gates of this topic. It is a huge topic. The issue of the heart, the matter of the shaitan, and how to keep our iman. It is a big issue. You may find hundreds of books. I am just mentioning the titles. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that yani, you get the benefit of it. At the end, Jazakumullah khair wa sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.